Well, hello there. This is Caleb Jones, and this is the Alpha Male 2.0 podcast. And just to be clear and to make sure you have all the data, because I have a lot of questions about this, whatever platform you're listening to this podcast on, if that's SoundCloud, if that's Spotify, if it's iTunes, if it's on YouTube, this podcast is on about 6-7 different platforms. So if you don't like the current platform that you're currently listening to this podcast on, go to calebjones.com/podcast. And I'm sure you'll be able to pick a platform there that you probably like better if you dislike the platform that you're currently listening to this podcast on, just to make sure. I'm everywhere these days. Matter of fact, shortly I'm going to be in many more places, but that's a discussion for another time. As most of you know, I have moved out of the country. I have moved to Dubai, and I did a podcast on that a few weeks ago on my life changes since moving to Dubai. And in this podcast, I wanted to give you the negatives that I've encountered in terms of moving out of the country. I don't want to just give you a rosy Pollyanna picture of if you move out of your country, everything will be fine, everything will work perfectly, you won't have any problems. That's not true. And as always, I am here to give you the facts. I am here to give you objective reality, unlike most other content providers who are there to give you their emotions and their feelings and how they think things should work and how they wish things would work. I'm here to tell you how things actually work. So although moving out of the country was one of the best decisions of my entire life, and this is a decision that is going to benefit all aspects of my life, not only now, but it will compound over time, next 5 years, 10 years, 20 years plus, because of this decision. So this is a fantastically good decision. I would have made this decision, even if it was 10 times harder to do, I still would have made the same decision. At the same time, there have been some problems and there's been some issues in making this transition. And some of these issues I expected. I planned on having problems. When you make a transition in your life this large, you're gonna have some issues. Some of these things I did not plan on, and I'll go into those in a minute. When you make a transition this large, you'll encounter some problems. You'll encounter some hiccups. You'll encounter things that piss you off. You'll encounter things that bother you, at least temporarily. You'll encounter things that piss you off, at least temporarily. You'll encounter a lot of inconveniences. And that's just the way it goes. That's the price you pay for making a transition this large. Now, here's the good news. The good news is that the majority of these problems that I've experienced, I'm going to go through all of them in a second, are because I have, unlike most of you listening to this podcast, I have a lot more life infrastructure than most of you. So most of you, at least statistically and based on the analytics, most of you, or at least the plurality of you, are under the age of 35. You're under the age of 35, you probably don't have a wife like I do. You probably don't have an animal in your life. She has a dog. You probably don't have that. You probably don't have multiple companies like I do. You probably don't have a lot of the infrastructure that I have built up over the last 50 years of my life. I'm about to turn 49. And so when you are young and you don't have a girlfriend, you don't have a wife, you don't have a lot of, you know, investments and businesses and a lot of those kinds of things, it's actually easier to make this transition in terms of moving out of the collapsing Western world and into a less bad country. So you will not have, most likely, the problems that I have had or the inconveniences that I have had. You might, but you probably won't, or you probably won't have as many. Now, if you older guys, you guys are in my age range, if you're in your 40s, 50s, or beyond, and you've got kids, you've got a wife, or at least a significant other, you've got, you know, business interests, you've got investments, maybe you have real estate, what have you, then yes, you're going to encounter a little more problems when you make this transition. And again, I want to reiterate, these problems are still worth it. Again, if I had 5x the problems that I've currently had, I would still have moved out of the country. I would still have moved to Dubai. That wouldn't have changed my decision. I'm just letting you know the whole picture here. And hopefully, if you hear the kind of problems that I've encountered, it will help you to avoid a lot of these problems, because some of these I did not anticipate. Some of them I did. A lot of them I did. Some of them I didn't. So hopefully this will help you out regardless. And I've said this before, the vast majority of the content that I create, both in my business content and in my dating and relationships content, is content that I wish I had when I was a young man. This is stuff that I talk about that I wish I had in my 20s and early 30s. The vast majority of my content is the content that I would have taken out a $100,000 mortgage out of my house back then for this information, for most of my information. And this is no different. So this is the kind of information that I wish I had when I was younger. And so you can learn not only from the techniques that I've used in my life that worked, but also the problems that I've had, at least in my past. I've had a lot of problems in my life lately, but things like when I got divorced years ago and things like that, you can also learn from my failures and my mistakes to avoid those things. So, few problems, few things that have come up in no particular order. Well, actually, I'll give you the biggest one first. So the biggest one is my wife, Pink Firefly, unfortunately, I've mentioned this before, has a dog. Now, it's barely a dog. It is what's called a teacup Yorkie. It's 3 pounds. It literally fits the palm of your hand. I mean, barely, but it's a teeny tiny little thing. And so the only points of contention that we ever had when we first moved in together, anyway, I had this lately, when we first moved in together was over this goddamn dog. And I like dogs, but I'm not a dog person. So I should probably describe the difference, because there is a distinct difference between someone who really likes dogs, like me, and a dog person. Matter of fact, you may be a dog person. But the difference between someone who loves dogs and a dog person, I'll just give you this scenario. So if you go to someone's house, right? I've had this experience, and maybe you've had this experience too. You go to someone's house, they have a dog, right? You visit their home. And you walk in the front door or whatever, and the big dumb dog goes, and he jumps up on you, and he slobbers all over you because he's so excited to see you, and you're like, holy shit, he's getting fur all over you. If the owner of that dog is a person who loves dogs, that person says, oh my God, I'm so sorry, and he grabs the dog by the collar and goes, come on, Rover, and he pulls the dog into a bedroom down the hall, and he puts the dog in the room and shuts the door, right? That's what a dog owner does who loves dogs. Now, let me switch the scenario, and now it's the exact same scenario, although now it's not a person who loves dogs. It is a dog person. A dog person. A dog person is not someone who loves dogs. A dog person is someone who treats dogs like human beings. So dog people are people who sleep with their dogs. They've got pictures of their dogs on their desk at work. They, you know, they spoon their dogs. They make out with their dogs. These are dog people. So if you go to a dog person's house and the dog jumps up on you, starts slobbering all over you and whatever, and, you know, getting fur all over you, the dog person walks over and says, Rover, stop that. And that's all they do. And of course, the dog completely ignores them, and he's slobbering all over you, getting fur all over your clothes. And you have to like, okay, Rover, you got to like shove the dog off you, and you got to wipe the slobber off you, right? The person doesn't really do anything. Rover, stop it. Other than saying, Rover, stop it. Get down. Stop it, Rover. You know, they're not going to physically put the dog into a bedroom. That would be mean to the dog. So so you sit down on the person's couch, right? I know you've had this experience. I've had it throughout my life. You sit down on the person's couch, and the dog runs right over to you and shoves his snout right in your crotch, right? Right in your crotch. He jams his snout right up your ball sack. And so now he's, you know, you got slobber and you got the slime coming out of his nose. You're getting all of your pants. And you're like, okay. And finally you can't stand it. So you shove the dog, not hard. You don't hurt the dog. But you finally shove the dog because the dog person owner isn't doing shit about it. And then the dog person owner, when that person sees you shove their dog, they look at you and go, oh, you don't like dogs? Okay, so that's a dog person. No, dumb fuck, I love dogs. I don't like dogs snouts shoved up my ball sack. Thank you very much. Okay, so my wife, my lovely, wonderful wife, as well as my daughter, by the way, are both dog people. And so they worship their dogs. Their dogs are like their children. Matter of fact, in many respects, Pink Firefly's dog is her child. Because Pink Firefly has no children, she will never have any actual human children. So this is a surrogate child. And by the way, what few women in the universe who never have children, these women generally have cats or dogs. The old story about the crazy cat lady, right? Well, that's why they do it. These are surrogate children. So in a way, this is her fucking child. And so we discovered in this process of me moving out to Dubai, or us moving to Dubai, that there would be a four-month delay, a four-month process to get the dog approved to import it into the country of Dubai. And kind of a problem. 4 months is a long time. And I could give you all the details on what is required and why it took 4 months, but just it's not super relevant. Some countries are very strict about the importation of animals. Australia is very, very strict. Dubai is actually less strict than a lot of countries. Although even in Dubai, there are some breeds of dogs that aren't even allowed. So we're lucky that her breed was allowed. But anyway, it was going to take 4 months. And the total fees to bring the dog in was something like, I forget now, because this is, you know, a few weeks ago, something like $5,000 or $6,000 just to bring the fucking dog into an airplane into the country from another country. So we discovered this, you know, into the process where I was already, you know, getting plane tickets to come out and da 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 da. And so when we discovered this, her and I sat down and looked at options. And of course, option one was, hey, you know, you could always get rid of your dog, but she is a dog person. So the answer is hell no. The dog is my baby. Okay. And so option two that she told me, and she goes, well, you could just move back. Because I was actually in Dubai when this occurred. So she said, you could just move back to the United States for another 4 or 5, 6 months this year. And, you know, and I said, hell no, I am never moving back to the collapsing United States. Fuck the United States. I'll visit there. I'm never gonna live there. Are you kidding me? No, no, no. Plus it would fuck up a lot of my tax plans for this year, which is the entire reason, or at least reason number one, that I'm doing this. So that wasn't an option. So we went round and round, looked at different options. The plan originally was for us to fly out to Dubai and then find an apartment for both of us that we would settle in long term. And so as we kind of screwed around, she basically said, okay, well, I'll stay here for 4 months or 3 months, whatever it was. Go ahead, go to Dubai. I could fly back and visit her. She could fly and visit me for 4 months. It'd be, you know, it's bad, but we could handle 4 months. It wouldn't be 4 contiguous months. It would just be a few weeks at a time over a 4 month period. And then I said, well, okay, if I'm going to do that, then fuck it. I don't want to be in an Airbnb for 4 months or at a hotel for 4 months. I'll just get an apartment here, a small one for me. And then you can come out here. We'll live in a smaller apartment for a few months while we figure this out. And then what have you, because you, you know, it would have to be a year lease or a 6 month lease or what have you. And so when I said that, she's like, well, then, you know, shit, I don't want to do that. So maybe I just stay here until blah, blah. So long story short, what we decided to do was that she's going to get an apartment. And as I record this podcast, this is happening in a week. She's going to get an apartment in the United States until October 1st. And at that time, I will come back to the United States and we will get a place, a temporary place or a permanent place or a part-time place in Arizona. And which would mean then that I'm going to live in Dubai and she's going to leave the United States for 6 months. And so we're going to have this kind of weird long distance marriage for a while where once a month or once every 5 to 6 weeks, she'll fly out to Dubai for a week or two and visit with me. I'll fly back to the United States for a week or two and visit with her. Maybe we could even combine these two visits. And so it's not like we won't see each other for 6 months. That wouldn't be sustainable. That would be silly. But there will be several blocks of time where we won't see each other for several weeks in a row. And we were already apart from each other. As I'm recording this podcast, I'm actually back in the United States right now because I want to help her move out of our house into this apartment. And so we were apart for 5 weeks straight. We've never been apart for 5 weeks that long. The longest we've ever been apart is 3 weeks. And even that was a little difficult, especially for her. 5 weeks was pretty bad. What's interesting with me is that I have never missed a woman in my entire life. I've never missed anybody in my entire life. So if I go on long trips, historically, you know, week, 2, 3 weeks, sometimes 4 weeks, I won't miss any woman that I'm dating. When I was married the first time, I never missed my first wife. I didn't miss my kids. I love these people, but I didn't miss them. Pink Firefly is the first woman or first person in my life I actually missed. And so I missed her for 5 weeks. She missed me badly for 5 weeks. It was hard for her. And so now we know that 5 weeks is probably too long to spend time apart, but we did that. And just so you know, her rule is she can only survive, quote unquote, because she's a dog person, for a maximum of 2 weeks without her dog. So she'll fly anywhere in the world and visit me or what have you, go on a trip, what have you. But there's a max period of time in Pink Firefly's world for 2 weeks. And then she has to come back and visit her dog. So unfortunately, we're going to have to just dick with that this year. It's going to be a pain in the ass. We don't like it. I'm not happy about it. She's not happy about it. It's going to be, you know, a little expensive in terms of plane tickets and things like that. Again, still worth it. But this is an example of the kinds of things that can come up when you move out of the country, especially if you have a significant other like this. And maybe you don't have a significant other with a dog, but maybe you are a married guy and you have kids. And unfortunately, a lot of guys use their kids as an excuse. Well, I can't move out of the country, Caleb. I have kids. Horse shit. I've seen lots of guys move out of the country with kids, including small kids. I've seen profiles on YouTube of guys who've done this. I've talked to 2 or 3 guys who've done this. Tim Ferriss has profiled a lot of guys who've done this. So that's not an excuse, but it does make things more complicated. It increases the odds of problems, and that does happen. So that's certainly a challenge, and it's all temporary. It's not a big deal, but this is just an example of the problems that arise when you make this transition. So another problem is, this is something that is irritating, but it was a big irritant. So when I was in Dubai last for 5 weeks, as some of you know, I was in an Airbnb for 5 weeks, and the plan was to complete my residency, my permanent residency card in Dubai, my actual legal residency, while I was a legal resident there. And there's a 4-part process when you become a legal resident in Dubai. And it's usually pretty quick. It usually takes just a few weeks, assuming you do everything correctly, a few weeks from when you're there. And I'm exaggerating when I say a few weeks. A few weeks once certain things are done. I can give you the entire process, but it's probably not relevant since the vast majority of you listening to this are probably never moving to Dubai. But anyway, it takes a few weeks. And so my plan was to get there, just temporarily have my stuff in an Airbnb, all my boxes and boxes and boxes of stuff, and sitting there in my Airbnb ready to be unloaded into my real apartment. And I was planning on being there maybe 2 or 3 weeks, maybe 4 on the outside of those 5 weeks to move into my apartment. Well, thank you, Mr. COVID, or should I say governmental COVID hysteria. Because of COVID hysteria, there is now a huge exodus of people from Europe, where it's really, really bad in terms of lockdowns, who are moving to Dubai. So Dubai is a place a lot of people are moving to, which is just as well. It's a great place. And because of this, there is now this huge backlog at the UAE government for approving these residencies, number one. Number two, there was also a change in the law late last year where now there is a new process, a new piece of the process, which they call a migration process. It's migrating paperwork from one department to another department, which causes another delay. So long story short, I'm in my Airbnb and I'm regularly looking at apartments to move into, working with rental agents and things like that. And I was saying, well, I should have my, you know, my Emirates card, which is the residency card. I should have my Emirates card, you know, by next week or what have you. And you can't rent an apartment, an extended lease, you know, a year or whatever, without having one of these cards. You just can't do it. It's even difficult to open a bank account in Dubai without these cards. You can, but it's more difficult. So the guy said, so do you have your residency card? Not yet, but it's coming. I said, what part of the process are you in? I would tell them, they would say, oh, okay, good. You're about a week and a half away. No problem. Yeah, so as soon as you just give me a copy of your passport, I'll hold the apartment, blah, blah, blah. I actually found 2 apartments that I really liked and was all ready to move in. And finally, I get an email or a text, I should say, WhatsApp, from one of my relocation guys. And he says, hey, I'm really sorry to tell you that you're not going to get your Emirates ID by, you know, March 15th when you are leaving back to the United States for a while. And I'm like, fuck. And the reason that's a problem is because I have 13 boxes of my stuff stacked up in my little Airbnb that I was going to just move to the new apartment and set up. If I can't find an apartment by the time I came back to the United States, and it's not just the US, I'm also going to Paraguay and Panama on this trip, I would have to go back to the original storage company that I've been using for the past year or so. It's a mobile storage company where they bring guys to your house. Guys actually come to your house. They pack your stuff up and take it to a storage facility. And then when you arrive again, they deliver it back to you. It's a nice service. But I'd have to actually, you know, have the guys come and take all 13 boxes, pack all that shit up again, and store it again for another, you know, month or what have you, for until I return to Dubai, which means that when I return to Dubai, I won't be able to get an Airbnb because I will have my Emirates card as soon as I arrive. That part's in the bag. That's the good news. But I can't rent an Airbnb because with an Airbnb, you have to know exactly when you leave the Airbnb. So when I go back to Dubai in a few weeks after I hit South America, I'm going to have to stay in a hotel with just my little backpack of stuff and live off that. Find an apartment as fast as I can, which won't be any big deal because there's plenty of good apartments there. Then get to the apartment, then get out of the hotel, then have the storage guys return my stuff. Just a big fucking hassle and not fun at all. Again, not a big deal, but something that really pissed me off at the time because I was scrambling. I kept bugging my relocation guys. Hey guys, where are we? I need to rent this apartment. And I've got, you know, 9 days left. Okay, I got 7 days left. I got 4 days left. What are we doing this, guys? So it sucked. And it was kind of stressful, but that's the way it goes. So that's another problem I ran into. Some other problems are little logistical problems. And these are the problems that I expected. Things like, well, I'm on TRT. I'm also on ipamorelin and metformin, a bunch of other anti-aging human growth hormone things. And so I have to order them when I'm in the United States, pack them up, take them with me when I go back to Dubai. And that's kind of a hassle. At some point, I can find a source for these things in Dubai. Maybe I won't be able to find a source for all of them. Maybe I'll be able to find a source just for some of them, and do like a half Dubai, half US thing. When Pink Firefly moves to Dubai with me early next year after we get our place in Arizona, I'm not going to be in the United States very often. So what does that then mean? Does that mean that my doctor in the United States ships my stuff to Dubai, which sometimes can take as long as a month? I don't know. So that's something I have to figure out. Kind of a pain in the butt, but a logistical problem that I expected. There may be lots of little things or a few little things in your life that are easy to obtain in your home country that are complicated or impossible to obtain in your new country. And you need to prepare for that. And so what you need to do, and I did this, I sat down and made a big list of everything in my life. What do I need in a typical week? What do I need to do in a typical month? And how do I handle those things in the new country? Can I get them in the new country? Can I not get them in the new country? Are they illegal in the new country? Are there import regulations in terms of moving them from one country to another? Things like that. Oh, here's another problem I ran into. So by my bed, I have a, what's called an Allen, A-L-E-N, purifier. It's an air purifier. It's like a big giant white box with a fan inside with a big, very expensive filter. It's like $100 for the filter. These air filters, the entire unit is about $500 or $600. It is the top of the line, best air purifier you can buy. And I used to have two, one downstairs and one by my bed. So I'm constantly breathing perfectly clean, amazing air as I'm sleeping and then as I'm working. The one down by my office, this is when I lived in the United States, finally broke after many years. And so I had one left upstairs in my bedroom. Well, I looked at Amazon in Dubai and other websites in Dubai, because there's a separate Amazon for every country. So there's a UAE Amazon. And I looked to see if I could order one of these air purifiers in the UAE. And the answer is I couldn't. So when I shipped over, I didn't ship actually, when I packed 8 boxes of stuff to move over with me when I flew out, at using Emirates Airlines, one entire box was full of this gigantic air filter, which barely fit. It barely fit in the regulation size carry-on, not carry-on, but check-in boxes. So I was barely able to fit this thing. And when I finally arrived in Dubai, I hooked it all up. It worked fine for a little bit. Then it started making this weird noise. Then it started smelling funny. And then it just wouldn't work right. So basically it broke. It's a pretty sensitive piece of equipment, and it probably didn't like being thrown around at an airport, two different airports. So my wonderful, awesome, very expensive air purifier was useless. I had to throw the thing away. And so now if I want that air purifier, and I do, I have a lot of extra filters for it and things, I'm going to have to order it in the United States, most likely, and ship it to Dubai, which will take a fucking month. And I can't ship it now because I don't have a shipping address set up in Dubai yet because I don't have an apartment. See, these problems kind of cascade on each other. So what I'm going to have to do is once I get my apartment, get settled over there, I'll have to have Pink Firefly or my business manager, the Ginger Ninja, one of those two people, I have to order this thing on Amazon and then receive it and then immediately turn around and ship it to my address in the UAE, which may take a month. And it's going to cost $1 billion to ship. And that's just the way it goes. So that's another problem. Again, I anticipated, well, what if certain things break when I bring over 8 boxes of stuff with me? Here's the good news. The only other things that broke was a funny coffee cup I wanted to keep and one of my big fancy light bulbs, big spiral weird light bulbs for the lighting I use for my YouTube videos, which is a replaceable item. It's just a weird item, but it's replaceable. Those are the only two things that broke out of 8 boxes of stuff other than that air purifier. So that's pretty damn good. That's actually better than I was expecting, because I was expecting a few things to break. So I was kind of impressed with that. Emirates Airlines, as I mentioned before in YouTube videos, is the number one or number two best rated airline in the world. And that's the airline you use when you travel to and from Dubai. So that's really it. I'm going to be, as of the recording of this podcast, I'm going to be in the United States for another 2 weeks or so. Next week, I get Pink Firefly settled in her temporary apartment for 6 months. And then I leave the United States and I head to Panama and then to Paraguay for about 2 weeks. And then I'm back in Dubai. And when I'm back in Dubai, I'm looking for an apartment again. At least now I know. Here's the good news. I've looked at so many goddamn apartments in Dubai because of this process. I know pretty much exactly where I want to live, the best buildings where I want to stay, I know the parameters of the type of apartment I want. So the good news is, and my visa is all ready. My Emirates ID is going to be ready very, very quickly as soon as I arrive. And so that's the good news. I'll be able to get into an apartment pretty damn fast once I get into Dubai. But I won't have any of my stuff at my hotel room, just my little backpack of stuff, my travel backpack. And that's it until I find a place. So, you know, way it goes. So that's just some examples of some problems that you can run into when you move out of the country. You always have to plan ahead for these things. You want to plan ahead for all kinds of problems that you might have, contingency problems, things like that. You want to plan ahead for these things because this is a big move, moving out of the country. That's why so few people do this stuff. They're so terrified of all these little problems that they never actually make the move, and they just stay in their collapsing Western countries and they're fucked. So that's it. This is a topic a lot of you are curious about, so I will certainly do more podcasts on moving out of the country. Matter of fact, I have a course coming up in a few months on exactly how to do it, but we'll have more information on that later. I will see you very, very soon.